I'd like to start off by saying that I have an answer to prayer. Brenda and I, well, don't say that yet. Brenda and I were going over the finances this week, and she said, something's got to give. Something's got to give. And I said, okay, let's pray about it. So we sat and we prayed about it and asked God, give me the sign. Give me the sign. So I prayed about it, and I went over to my computer, started working on some things, and an email pops up. It was an email that promised me, a lady from Nigeria that just died, her husband died, promised me $7 million. The building is going to be paid off. But then I asked Brenda, I said, hey, we're going to get the $7 million, but I need a check for $5,000 so I can send it to her so she'll send me a check for $7 million. And she said, okay. So we got in the office and rewrote that check for $7,000 because we prayed and God gave me a sign. And if I got that sign right after I prayed, it surely must have been from God. Right? You ever fall into that myth? That urban legend? That surely if we ask God about it, and surely if it's what we have seen, surely it has to be true. But sometimes we have to remember that your daddy told you something. If it's too good to be true, it's too good to be true. So sometimes just because we ask something doesn't mean it's going to be something. So we're going to take a few weeks and we're going to talk about myth busters. Things in the Bible that you have heard and sometimes we believe that are totally false. And sometimes because we have believed that and sometimes because we have learned that within our life that when it doesn't take place, then we are goofed up. We wonder where God is. We wonder what's going on in our life because surely what I have heard and what I've believed has to be the real deal. And sometimes what we have heard and what we believe is a form of the truth, but it has no truth in it. The first mythbuster. And some of you parents are going to say, oh no, right off the bat. Godly parents would never have ungodly kids. Isn't that a myth? If you're a parent, there's times in our lives that we have ungodly kids. And there's time in our life that we as parents are ungodly. And it also says just because you are ungodly doesn't mean that you cannot have godly kids. But sometimes we feel that if our kids are going to goof up, then I'm not a very godly person. And there's two couples I want to introduce you to. First one is Sharon and Jim. Sharon and Jim have three boys. And one of their boys is a preacher. And they are so proud of the preacher boy. He's doing the right thing. And he's doing what he has called to do. But he has two other sons. And those two other sons are not doing what God wants them to do. They're outside doing their own life. And they are so feeling guilty of those two boys because they're not like that other son. And they go through their life feeling guilty, feeling that they did not do the right thing, feeling that they should have been better parents. And they are ridden by guilt because two of their kids are not doing what they think God wants them to do. And they feel guilty about that. They say feel so guilty about it that they're not enjoying their life. They get angry. They get depressed. They lose all energy because they have wrapped their life around two boys that is not doing exactly what God wants them to do. And they feel guilty. They feel disillusioned. They feel unwarranted in their guilt because they just feel that they'll never be who God wants them to be. And then there's another couple by the name of Mike and Rhonda. Mike and Rhonda has one girl. And this one girl is so far away from God. She grew up in church and she got saved at Vacation Bible School. And she knew Jesus as her Lord and Savior when she was a child. But when she graduated from high school, she graduated from God. And she had left every bit of her spiritual condition behind her. And her mom and dad are sitting there saying, we're praying for her. But we know what the Bible says. The Bible absolutely says that she will definitely come back to the church. And that's where this disillusionment comes in. Because the Bible does not say that your child will come back. The Bible does not say that. Godly parents may have ungodly kids every once in a while. But here's the misconception. In Proverbs chapter 22, verse 6, it says, something that's entirely different than what we believe. The general observation of Proverbs chapter 22 and verse 6, it says, train up a child in the way he should go, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. Here's our misconception, and here's what we believe, and here's the myth. We believe that if I do my job and my child rebels, that child, when he is old, will come back. So I don't have to pray about it. I don't have to worry about it. I don't have to even care about it. But the Bible does not say that. And that is not a promise. It is a proverb. A promise is a God-given promise. And it says, when something takes place, I am going to make sure it happens. But a proverb is an evaluation of the society or the culture that it was in. And it says, train up a child in the way he is bent, or the way that he has moved, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. It doesn't say he's going to leave and come back. It means when we train up a child, when we love that child, we understand who that child is, that child's bent. And when that child is trained and loved and godly, that child may walk away. But that child may come back. And the Bible doesn't say he will. It says he can. It's a proverb. It's not a promise. A proverb is something that we evaluate in the culture, and it is a likelihood, but it's not a necessity, and it's not a promise from God. Now, we understand the prodigal son, the prodigal left, and the father sitting at the door waiting for that son to come back. He was moved with compassion. When you say, well, this prodigal son came back, the prodigal son is not the story of the Bible. The story of the Bible is about the father that loved his son more than he hated his sin. And the prodigal father said, I want to love you no matter what you have done. We have to look. Just because our kids may have done something wrong doesn't mean that they're bad. But we do must love them and help them. And just because they're bad doesn't mean we are bad parents. I have two boys. And both of my boys, preacher kids. Oh, man. Little hellions is what they are, but no, they're not. But you know what? Both of those boys, and you know them, they've grown. I've been a pastor for 18 years, and you've seen them since they were 5 years old and since he was 1 year old. You've seen them grow up. And you know that those two boys have totally, totally different personalities. One is athletic and wants to be a physical trainer. The other is a musician, and he wants to be a sound engineer. They are totally different in their looks and their acts, the way they handle each other and everything, even in the way that I discipline them. Brett played basketball, and Brett's basketball coach got in his face. So if I was passive with Brett, he wouldn't even listen to me. But if I got in Brett's face, he would listen to me. But if I got in Bryson's face, he'd be scared. But if I passively tried to discipline Brett, he wouldn't care. But if I aggressively tried to discipline Bryson, he would be scared and it would not work. I have to know that this boy needs this discipline. Train up a child in the way he should go or the way he is bent, and when he's old, he will not depart from it. My discipline and my love for him, I have to learn what he needs and what makes him tick. And when we do that, it is an opportunity for us to train. So the misconception of godly parents will never have ungodly kids, it's a total misconception. It causes grief, guilt, and fear. But what happens when that child doesn't return? What happens when that child is a reprobate, a prodigal, if you would? Proverbs is called Proverbs for a good reason. The righteous aren't always honored. The wicked sometimes succeed. The diligent can lose it all. And the lazy can strike it rich. We can go down to the quick shop and we can buy 500 lottery tickets and we can strike it rich and you don't have to do anything for it except for spend money. We can do that. It doesn't mean that only the successful, only the wealthy, only the smart are godly. It is all over the board. Proverbs 22:6, train up a child in the way he should go. First part of that. Our job is to train up a child. Train him up. Love him. Train him up in righteousness. Train him up in the church. Train him up with the Bibles. Train him up in the youth ministry, in the children's ministry. Train him up in the home. Our job is to train. And when we train, it doesn't mean that they're not going to rebel. It does not mean that they're not going to sin. But it does mean our job is to train. Our job is to let them have an opportunity. I like the Amplified Bible. It says, train up a child in the way he should go, and in keeping with his individual gift or bent. And when he is old, he will not depart from it. The individual bent. I've tried and I've looked at the Bible, and I've never seen too many kids that are brothers and sisters or brothers that act exactly the same. Cain and Abel were different, totally different. They didn't act the same. They had different personalities and different gifts and different things. When we look at what God wants us to do, he says, and when he is old, he will not depart from it. So what do we do? What do we do when we feel guilty? Maybe we're trying to do what's right and we're trying to train up our kids, but many of us may have rebellious kids, and it may be a kindergartner or it may be a 25-year-old adult, but they're rebellious, and you say, what do I do about rebellion? Is it my fault? Is it my responsibility? Am I guilty? Did I not do a good enough job? When we look at what our kids are doing, we have to train up a child in the way he should go. Our job is to train up the child. And when he is old, he is past your responsibility. He will not depart from it. That's a proverb. It is not a promise. But what we have to do, we have to take the proverb and put it into practice. Train up a child in the way he should go. That's your job, and that's my job. Give them the word of God. Give them everything that they have. But when they are old, it is their responsibility. Ezekiel chapter 18, verse 20. The soul who sins shall die. The son shall not bear the guilt of the father, nor the father bear the guilt of the son. The righteousness of the righteous shall be upon himself, and the wicked of the wicked shall be upon himself. You have to stand before God for you. Your kids will have to stand before God for them. Now, I know as parents, we're trying to do the helicopter parenting thing sometimes. And I don't want my child to stand before God. I want to baby my child. I want my God to be safe. And I know I do too. But at the same time, those kids that are 5 years old, 15 years old, they are going to grow up. And you're not going to be able to have your arms around them all day. You're not going to be able to make those decisions. That's why the Bible says, train up a child while they're young. Train up a child. And when he is old, when it's not your responsibility, if we have done our job, hopefully we're going to take what we have taught them and they're going to live within it. But it doesn't mean they are going to all the time. It doesn't mean that. I was a youth pastor for many years, and you know, when I was a youth pastor and I didn't have kids, I could tell those kids how to live and I could tell those parents how to parent, but I didn't know anything about it. If you just do this, this, and this, it'd be okay. But I've learned a lot over the last few years that it is not that easy. And I found this, I wish I had written it, but I didn't. 10 rules for raising godly kids. When I was a youth director, I would have said, that's mine. But then it moved to 10 guidelines of raising good kids. And then it went from 5 strategies for raising kids. And then the last one is 3 suggestions to surviving parenthood. Because there's no easy answer. There's no easy answer. Parenting is a very difficult job. Parenting is out there. You go to Walmart, you go to Dillon's, and you see kids, and you look at the parent, and you say, why don't you just discipline the child? Why are you letting that little child throw a temper tantrum? And because you are a parent and you wouldn't have handled that way, we criticize parents. And we have no idea what's going on in that child's life. But parenting is very open and in front of everybody. You say, well, how can I do that? Does the Bible give us instructions? It does give us instructions, and I want to spend a few minutes on those instructions. In Deuteronomy chapter 6, verses 6 through 9, God is telling us through Moses, he said, take parenting serious. You have 18 years that you have your child, and those 18 years are important. If you do not do what I've asked you to do in these 18 years, your kids may not have a passion, love for your God. And the second or third generation Christianity may not take place within their life. You have an 18-year window, and you can shrink that down to maybe a 7 or 8-year window, because once they get defiant, they're not going to listen to you. You have to train them while they're moldable. And that's why children's ministry is so important. That's why these Bibles are so important, because we are molding children's lives with their hearts and their minds. In Deuteronomy, it says this, "And these words which I command you today shall be in your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children, and shall talk to them as you sit in your house, when you walk by the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up. You shall bind them in your sign on your hand, and they shall be the frontlets between your eyes. You shall write them on the doorpost in your house and on your gates." In other words, there's not a time in your life that you have a child with you that they should not see the things that you believe in. That everything that you do and everything that we say, they should have God surrounded within our life. Every part of it. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 4 says, "And you fathers, do not provoke your children to wrath, but bring them up in the training and the admonition of the Lord." Training and the admonition of the Lord. In all my counseling, when talking about parenting, I use this analogy. And you guys that's going to counseling with me, you say, "Oh, I hear this all the time." But I want to do it one more time. I believe discipline and training a child is like coaching. Our job as a coach is they bring a bunch of kids into the gymnasium, and these kids don't know anything about life. They don't know anything about basketball, and they have a basketball game in 5 weeks. And the job of a coach is to teach the kids how to play the game of basketball, because sooner or later the game is going to be played. And if they do not know how to play the game, you cannot win the game if they don't know the rules, they don't know the boundaries, they don't know the meaning of the game. And the coach's job is to teach them the game and then teach them how to play the game, how to shoot the basketball, how to play the right sports and how to do the right things. And if the coach has done their job, when the basketball game is about ready to be played, the kids know what to do and how to do it. Whether they win or not is not the coach's job necessarily. The job of the coach is to teach them how to and to train them too. And the same thing with parenting. Train up a child in the way he should go, coach a child in the way he should play. And when the game starts, you can set back because your job is done. My kids have moved out. I have moved from being a parent to my child to be a friend of my boys. And I love that. I have done my job. I don't know if they're going to ever make a mistake. I don't know if they're ever going to goof up. But you know what? If they do, I want to be like the prodigal father that opens my arms wide open to them and love them more. Then I have to remember what I have done and that God loves me. It is not a reflection of me whether they make a mistake. It's a reflection of me whether I've done my job right. As a coach, do they know the rules of life? Do they know what the out of bound line is? If they go out of bounds after they know it's out of bounds, guess what? There's a penalty. But I can't take it personal that they stepped out of bounds. My job is to instruct them while they're young. Godly parents will have sometimes ungodly kids. And sometimes ungodly parents will have great kids because they know what the rules are. So I want to give you, just in closing, some instructions, some thoughts. And many of you say, "Yeah, that's common sense." But in parenting and training up a child in the way it should go, these are so valuable. The first one is to instruct verbally. To instruct verbally. Make sure you speak positive principles into your lives. Let them hear the expectations of their life. When the coach gets before the game, he stands up and he says, "Okay, guys, here's the strategy. Here are the starting players. Here's what we're going to do." In the middle of the game, there may be some exceptions. They may have to change the game plan, but he verbally tells them what the instructions are. And sometimes we have to go through life verbally communicating to our kids. There are homes that the dad spends less than 1 minute a day verbally communicating to their children. Verbally communicating. Not just how you doing. Verbally, how are you doing? What's going on in your life? How's school going? Verbally communicate. Make them interact. Because the old song goes, he grows up just like me. He's grown up just like me. I don't want my kids to grow up like me. I don't want other kids to act like me. I want my kids to know better and to live better. So instruct verbally, and then live authentically. Sometimes dads and moms, we have a few faces that we put on. And you know who knows us more than anybody else? Are the people that live in our house. It's kind of hard to lie. I tell you, it's hard. You're up here, and I'm glad they're gone now, but the kids are sitting in the audience, and I'm sitting here preaching a sermon, and they're saying, really? That's not who you are. They see past me. They see everything about me. Our kids know us better than we know ourselves. So what we have to do is we have to live our lives authentically in front of them and love patiently. Love patiently. You know, we sometimes get frustrated with our kids, but here's what we have to remember: how much God was patient with us. And what would God do if God treated us the way that we treat our kids when they make a mistake, when we have made just as many or just as much in mistakes? So we need to love patiently, and we need to discipline carefully. That's a big one. Discipline carefully. That means we have to look at the crime and the punishment. And we can't have the same punishment for every crime. The most popular punishment, anybody know what the most popular punishment for kids would it be? Take your phone. You just said it. Take your phone. Give me your phone. Give me your phone. Give me your phone. Give me your phone. Well, just take my phone. Okay? I'll go to the house and I got another one in the other room. So, you know, that's the most popular punishment. So if everything that we do and everything that they do is, here, take my phone, okay, or go to your room. Well, okay, I'll go watch TV and play, you know, PlayStation, whatever's in the room. I'll just do whatever. Their room has more stuff than the living room. And so that's not really a punishment. They don't want to talk to you anyway. So just discipline carefully. Understand what the need is. Understand what the punishment is. And love them through it. And here's the key when you're disciplining. They need to know why. And they need to know that they're loved. They need to know what the discipline is. And when they're done with the discipline, they need to know the discipline is over. That you're not mad at them. That you love them. And when we discipline thoroughly, I believe in discipline, but I also believe in restoration, bringing them back into the fold. Now, if they do it again, well, it's on again. But we have to discipline. And then give them roots and give them wings. Give them roots. Out of little acorns, mighty oaks grow. We have to plant that little acorn in the ground. Train up a child in the way he should go. That's the roots. We need to let them know what life is all about. We have to train them, love them, give them hope. And then it's time. And when they are old, they will not depart from it. That's a proverb. Oh, I hope it happens. But we all have kids, and we've all been a child. We've all made mistakes. And here's what the parents have to do. Fly. You have to fly. You can be like that eagle. That eagle has that little eaglet. But sooner or later, that eagle is getting kicked out of the nest. And that eagle, when he's kicked out of the nest, you know what he does? He flies. He either hits the ground or he flies, but those eagles, when they get kicked out of that nest, they open up their wings and they fly. What we have to do is we have to understand my job as a parent is to train up a child in the way he should go. And then I've done the roots. I've trained him everything I know how to do. I've given him the life principles and the coaching of life. And guess what? Now, it's time to fly. Now, will they goof up? Yeah, they'll do things you don't like. Will they make you mad? Yeah, a lot. But when they come back, you love them. You have to. Because here's the key. Godly parents will have sometimes ungodly kids. But those ungodly kids, what they need godly parents. How do you express to somebody that's in need that you love them? It doesn't mean that you wink at their sin. It doesn't mean that you don't love them because of the sin. What it means is, I love you more than I hate the sin. And if I love you more than I hate the sin, I can hug on you and I can talk to you and I can encourage you and I can be around you. And I'm not going to hurt you because of what you have done. I'm going to love you in spite of what you have done. Because godly parents sometimes do have ungodly kids. And sometimes ungodly kids need a godly parent, a godly advice. So what we have to do as parents, we have to love them. We have to give them instruction. We have to give them hope. We have to give them peace. And more importantly than anything else that we could ever do, is we have to give them God. We have to pray for them. We have to encourage them. Our invitation today is very simple. Many of us have kids. And kids, you have adults, you have parents. We need to pray for them. We need to pray for our kids by name on a daily basis. We need to call their name out. My kids are adults, and I still pray for my kids. I pray for what their grandkids are going to be, or my grandkids are going to be. I pray for them. But what we're going to do today for an invitation is open the altars for time prayer. Now, I know many of you. And I know some of your stories. And I know some of your pains. And I know some of your children's issues. And I want to pray for you. Because I know what you're going through is heartache. I know what you're going through is very difficult. And I know that if you do it on your own, you're going to continue in difficult and you're going to continue in guilt and fear. But if you give this thing over to God, say, God, they're not mine. You've given them to me, but I'm not really doing a really good job with it. I need you to kind of help me out with this thing. That's when we get on our knees before God and say, Lord, I need your guidance. You never know. You never know what's going to come around somebody's life, and somebody gets into their life and changes them and helps them and encourages them because of a prayer. Because you're asking God by name to help out your kids. Your kids may be unbelievers. They may be gone away. But still, they're your kids. We love them. And we need to be that prodigal father that sits patiently at the door, waiting for our kids to come back with open arms, loving our student more than we hate their sin. Because the student needs a dad, a mom that loves them unconditionally. Ungodly parents sometimes do have very ungodly kids. I wish it was true. I wish it would say that they will never leave, they would never sin, and they would never do anything wrong. But in reality, that's not true. But in reality, what we have to do is we have to prepare them, train them in the way they should go, push them out. You're on your own. And I pray when you're old, you will not forget the teachings I gave to you, and you'll come back, and you'll love me, and I'll love you.